language is an autonomous informational system. One may even call it an organism. And it runs in our brains. It doesn't actually have access to the other stuff going on in our brains. When we are talking about objects with features and colors, there's a sensory apparatus in our brain that is processing that information. Our linguistic system doesn't know about that. Our linguistic system is what we can call is ungrounded. It only knows about symbols. I call them meaningless squiggles. It knows the relationship between these meaningless squiggles. It knows that the word red tends to go together with the word apple and the word blue. And it knows that they're in certain relation to one another. But it doesn't know in any deep sense or any sense at all that these actually extend outside of the world of language itself. So the first observation here is that language is its own system. And what's true in silicon and what's true in these large language models, my claim is true in us as well. Now, when I'm standing here speaking before you, I have all kinds of things going on inside my brain. I'm thinking about visual imagery. I have a sense of my corporeality, my body. But there's a language model, an LLM, so to speak, that's running and speaking these words. It's doing it in conjunction with these other systems. It's receiving messages from them. But what it's really doing is just its own predictive engine. And this is a radical departure from the way we have thought about language until now. And when I say we, I mean the human species. There is something deeply intuitive or deeply unintuitive about this. There's a deep intuition that our language is in concert, is completely embedded with everything else, that when we are talking about things outside of language. So this is a very radical thesis that language has this property and that it, in fact, what is happening inside of us is in some ways is an autonomous informational system that isn't actually the same one as the rest of our cognitive architecture. One way to think about this is that culture itself has been planted within us, this informational system that's running. And for better or for worse, it is driving a lot of our behavior, but it isn't quite the same thing as the thing that feels, the thing that cares in some ways. So that's part one of the thesis, which you might think, well, that's enough. And indeed, I think that is leads to a dramatically different, almost existential view of certainly of knowledge and its place in our lives. But there's another piece with this, because not only is language auto-generative, there's something special about the way that the models do this generation. So the models do this thing called auto-regression, which is a word you'll hear me say a lot if you hang out with me. And autoregression is this particular way of doing prediction, where what you do is you take a sequence. Let's say the sequence, the cat sat on the, you can guess the next word. Maybe it's Matt. That's a popular ending, but there's other possible endings to that. So you might say you're predicting what that next word is. What we do in autoregression is you take a sequence, and then you produce the next most likely token or a word. We can just call it a word. And then you feed that back into the system, and it's recursive. So let's say it's the cat sat on the mat, and then what? Well, you know, I don't know. And then it got up, and it, you know, it walked around and rubbed against my leg, or something like that. This is all a reasonable sequence that could come after the cat sat on the. Now, what these models are doing, and this is a really important and astonishing point, is they are not thinking directly about the rest of that sequence. They are only ever doing the very next word, the very next token, as it's called. My thesis is that we are doing the very same thing. What we are doing in our minds, in our brains, is the same kind of computation. We are simply guessing the next token. And then we're taking that token and we hear it. It goes back into our own loop. And then we're saying, well, now there's a sequence with another word. The cat sat on the mat. And then what's next? And we say, okay, the cat sat on the mat, and then we say, okay, the cat sat on the mat, and what's next? And we do this over and over again. So what's magical about this is that even though we are, the models, I should say, are only doing this next token generation, there's something I call the pregnant present. In the process of guessing that very next token, they're taking into consideration all of the past and also the likely future. It has to project this kind of trajectory. Let's say you're doing a dance or you're walking. You have to take the next step with the knowledge that that next step is going to lead to a next step. And computationally, this leads to this sort of miraculous ability for these models to plot out very long range kinds of narratives, responses, it can seem like, oh, how could it be only the next token? But yet it is. And what this does is it leads to a possible theory of not only human language generation, but cognition more generally. Because what it provides is a very efficient and simple, elegant theory of what the brain is doing. The brain is computing this function over and over again. It's just computing the function of what's the next cognitive token. Given what's happened right up till this moment and the recent past, what should I do next? Then when you do that, that goes back into the loop and you proceed from there. And so this leads to, in some ways, a radically different view of what cognition really is. It, for example, leads to a completely different perspective of what memory is. Memory is not encoding of sequences. We don't actually have somewhere stored in our brain events that took place or something some fact that we've learned. What we actually have stored is just the capacity to auto-regressively generate. If I ask you a question, what did you do last summer? And you say, well, I went to this place, or you start imagining yourself, you know, jumping off of a cliff or something like that. What you're doing, according to this theory, is you're in real time, just in time, taking that question, that prompt, generating the very next output from that, and then running from there. What did I do last summer? Well, and then you continue to generate. And so that really leads to a completely different perspective on what memory is. It no longer is about storing facts. It's about having a brain, just like a large language model, that has these potentialities for facts. I call them potentialities because they're infinite. What does a large language model know? How many questions can you ask it? You can ask it an infinite number of questions and it can give a reasonable response to all those because it does this autoregressively. It's not retrieving this fact or that fact, rather it has the capacity to generate all of these facts. Finally, I'm probably over 5 minutes at this point, we can extend this even beyond language and linguistic responses, but to more broadly to cognition. As I mentioned, you know, thinking about a sequence, thinking about what am I going to do later on? I'm going to go hang out with my friends. Maybe I'm going to have to get in my car, things like that. All of this, any thinking that takes place over time, where you have to sit there and do this, right? What are people doing when they're staring into space? My argument is what people are doing is they are doing this autoregressive generation. We're living in this pregnant present where we're just constantly generating just the very next token and letting that flow. So I think we've got what we have actually through these large language models, not just a way of engineering really useful, helpful AI agents that can do stuff, but we've captured something really essential about how the mind works.
Will.
Fascinating. Obviously, Elon and I, we share a lot of these ideas in common. But one of the things that comes to mind right away, and we've discussed this before, is how surprisingly powerful this language model has been for doing what seems like non-language tasks. So the example I like to think of is if you imagine building like a robot or even like some kind of spaceship, and we go back a few decades, you would tend to think, all right, we're going to have this compute engine. We're going to have this kind of logic machine, and that's going to churn through facts, and it's going to deduce things and do inductions. And this is what AI in the 80s kind of looked like. And then maybe after you had that compute engine, you would then build a communication module that could talk kind of as like an add-on. That the ability to just communicate seemed at the periphery compared to the real thinking stuff, right? But what we've seen out of these models, and I think the best example is their ability to computer program, all of these capabilities just fell out of this token prediction. We didn't have to build an algebra engine or something that understands trigonometry or even optics. And when you think about when it generates the images, it gets reflections right. It gets speckles and bubbles and all kinds of things. It's learned a lot about physics. And you can do this with the language models as well. How is it that all that thinking horsepower just fell out of what seemed like the walkie-talkie, right? The communication module. So in a more general sense, I've been thinking about is our brain a computer? Is it a computer-like object? Is it fundamentally a different category? And or is it like the thing that you have in your phone or your laptop? And this has been highly debated for, you know, since Turing showed up on the scene. But I would argue that software, the idea of software, is the most important idea humans have come up with in maybe 1,000 years. Because it gives us a thinking tool, it gives us a token to understand a lot of these problems that previous philosophers and thinkers and cognitive scientists were just absolutely baffled by, and for no fault of their own. Things like the redness of red, or the pleasure and pain experience that we feel, and we wonder why does the vacuum cleaner not have that, and so on. And I think the real nature of this is we've discovered that we're software. And the more interesting thing that goes with that, in the technological world in the past few decades, we've now found out that software is actually more interesting than we thought.
Just a moment. Don't go anywhere. Hey, I see you inching away. Don't be like the economy. Instead, read The Economist. I thought all The Economist was something that CEOs read to stay up to date on world trends. And that's true, but that's not only true. What I found more than useful for myself, personally, is their coverage of math, physics, philosophy, and AI, especially how something is perceived by other countries and how it may impact markets. For instance, The Economist had an interview with some of the people behind DeepSeek the week DeepSeek was launched. No one else had that. Another example is The Economist has this fantastic article on the recent dark energy data, which surpasses even Scientific American's coverage, in my opinion. They also have the chart of everything. It's like the chart version of this channel. It's something which is a pleasure to scroll through and learn from. Links to all of these will be in the description, of course. Now, The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means that you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments. I am personally interested in the more scientific ones, like this one on extending life via mitochondrial transplants, which creates actually a new field of medicine, something that would make Michael Levin proud. The Economist also covers culture, finance and economics, business, international affairs, Britain, Europe, the Middle East, Africa, China, Asia, the Americas, and of course, the USA. Whether it's the latest in scientific innovation or the shifting landscape of global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage, and it goes far beyond just headlines. Look, if you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a new understanding, a deeper one, of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. I subscribe to them, and it's an investment into your intellectual growth. It's one that you won't regret. As a listener of this podcast, you'll get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now let's get back to the exploration of the mysteries of our universe. Again, that's economist.com/toe.